to introduce Fran Fraschilla.
I know the answer to this, but how many of you tweet? Raise your hand. How many of you follow me on Twitter? Okay, a few of you. How many of you in here who follow me think that I want Kansas to lose? Because I've gotten a few of those later, okay? You're one of those? Okay. I'm very honest, thank you. I could care less who wins a game when I broadcast it, honestly. Bill Self has been one of my close friends for 25 years. I do a lot of things for him in the offseason with his various charities. He's great to me. I've stayed at his house before, even before he got to Kansas. When I do a game, because I'm getting a little blowback from about 1% of the Kansas fans who follow me on Twitter. When it's Bill Self and Brad Underwood of Oklahoma State, another good friend of mine, or Scott Drew, and we're coming down to the final minutes, and it's a close game in Allen Fieldhouse, and you know the referees are going to help KU, but that's another story. when we come down to the final minutes, all I care about is I hope 23rd Street Brewery is open till 11, okay? It's all I care about is getting a good meal after a game, because all these coaches are friends of mine. And maybe it seems like sometimes you'd have that perception that I root for a team or root against a team. But because I'm at ESPN and I cover the Big 12, I love it when Buddy Hield gets 46 in here. I love it when Perry Ellis is a freshman. Some of you may remember back at the Big 12 tournament when he didn't play all that much of a prominent role throughout the regular season, Bernie. And then in a Big 12 tournament, he came out of nowhere. I love it when someone you've never heard of before, in the Big 12 particularly, plays great. Because I try to promote the entire league. And when Monte Morris comes in here at Allen Fieldhouse, probably my favorite place in basketball. It's not probably. It's my favorite place in college basketball to do a game. Is the St. Patrick's Cathedral of College Basketball, Allen Fieldhouse. But when Monte Morris comes in here and breaks that long streak, I have to treat Monte Morris just like Frank Mason when he's playing great. And sometimes that kind of gets a little bit twisted on Twitter. So I just want you to know, I don't care who wins. If Bill Self happens to lose a game occasionally, he still has a great life. Okay, he still has 13 straight championships, which is really cool. So I'm thrilled to be here. Okay, I married a sports administration or sports management graduate 28 years ago. I met her. I was a young assistant coach at Ohio University, which is kind of like the Harvard of sports administration programs. It was one of the very first. And we met when I was a young coach and she was a young sports administration graduate student. And I thought it'd be convenient because I knew I was going to coach and I figured it'd help to date somebody who likes sports, make my life easier, and it certainly did. And 28 years later, things have gone pretty well. I always tell people I've been happily married about 23 or 24, but she elbows me and she don't want me to say that. But I grew up in New York City. From the time I was 14, I wanted to be a college basketball coach. I had a laser-like focus on what I wanted to do with my life. I'm going to give you three or four bullet points today, kind of like what I call a championship game plan, okay? And give me a 15-minute mark, because I want to make sure we have time for questions. A championship game plan, okay? And it certainly worked for me. A lot of you in here have no idea what you want to do with the rest of your life, okay? I know that. Trust me. Believe me. A lot of you here are thinking about getting into sports, okay? But you're not sure what you want to do. You're not sure if you want to work for the NCAA, work for a pro professional team, become a college athletic director. Maybe there's a few people in here who want to coach. I'm not sure. You kind of in your head are kind of formulating that right now. I can only tell you my experience was when I was 14 years old, growing up in New York City, kind of the mecca of basketball, at least that's what we used to say, that I wanted to be a college basketball coach. And I was very lucky to make a lot of connections while I was in college. I went to Brooklyn College in New York City, first person in my family to ever go to college. Big Italian family. I just had this thought in my head I was going to be a college coach. And I was lucky to become a coach at the age of 21 years old. And I have not worked a day in my life. Okay, I do not have a job. I've never had a job. I've been paid well. I love what I do, but I've never had a job. 23 years as a coach. This is my 14th or 15th year at ESPN. And I've been blessed to do something I wake up every day. Like, here's a dumb question. People say, how do you prepare for a game? How do you get ready for a game? How do you know so much about the Kansas players and the Oklahoma State players? And I tell them, I've been doing this my whole life. Basketball is like in my DNA. Now, it's the toy department of life. It's much more important things in life out there. And some of you are going to go on and do other things besides get in sports. We get that. Lawyers, doctors, engineers, whatever. But I'm just telling you from my point of view, I've never worked a day in my life. Because I'm doing something I'm doing exactly what I always wanted to do, and that was basketball. Okay? Toy department of life. I want you to think about this. You have to begin with the end in mind. When we talk about your career, you must begin with the end in mind. Okay? There was a great business writer who's passed away. His name was Stephen Covey. Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, Bernie, right? About 30 years ago, it was a nationwide bestseller. You can still get it in bookstores everywhere. Seven Habits of Highly Successful People. And one of the things, I think the first chapter was begin with the end in mind. And for a lot of you right now, you're not sure where the end is in terms of your career. Understandable, okay? You're trying to figure all that out right now. But you gotta have a finish line. If you have goals, you gotta have a finish line. You gotta know if you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. Okay, I don't know who said that, but it always sticks in my head. If you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. That kid in Brooklyn all those years ago when he was 14, I knew the road I wanted to be on. Laser-like focus I had, okay? So begin with the end in mind. And I'm going to tell you a few stories about my coaching career, my broadcasting career. And by the way, I want to make sure we have a good 15 minutes at the end, because you can ask me anything you want. But here's an example of beginning with the end in mind. In 1996, I take over St. John's University basketball. Okay, at that time, they were the fifth winningest program in college basketball history. They've fallen off since then, kind of since I left, which is another story. I'll tell you about that later. But when I got there, they hadn't been to the NCAA tournament in 5 years, which was unheard of for St. John's. They had a great tradition, Hall of Famers. The coach there now, Chris Mullen, was a great player at St. John's. He went on to be a great NBA player, part of the Dream Team, and he's back trying to resurrect it. Well, anyway, I take over after what you'd call a storybook career at Manhattan College, one of those mid-major programs that comes out of nowhere and gets one of those March Madness upset wins. And so I go to St. John's. But before I tell you that story, because Bernie's here, the gentleman who ran this program prior to Jordan, his name was Bob Frederick. And he was the athletic director at KU. And I'll be forever, he's passed away, but he's beloved in his community, Bernie, is he not? Bob Frederick was the chairman of the basketball committee. He's in charge of, the committee that's going to meet next week in Indianapolis and pick the field of 68. Well, he was the chairman back then, and he was the athletic director right here on campus. And we were one of those mid-major teams, 26-4, that got beat in our conference championship game in double overtime. And our tournament started a week before, like this week, You guys don't know this, but championship week starts tonight. Okay, they're kicking off championship week. A lot of the mid-major and small conferences start the week before, right? Because ESPN spreads it all out and we put it all on television. Well, we get beat on the Monday, like it would be this coming Monday, like KU's last game is Saturday. Our championship game in Manhattan was that Monday, so we got beat in double overtime. So we had to wait 6 days to know whether we were getting in the field. And it didn't look good. And I was rooting for teams to win and lose and knock this off, and this team knocks this off, because there's only so many spots in the NCAA tournament. And come Selection Sunday night, our name pops up on the CBS screen. Manhattan College. Manhattan College, number four, Oklahoma, coached by the brilliant Kelvin Sampson, will take on Manhattan College out of New York City. And we jump up, we go nuts. You've seen it, right? All the kids go crazy. And a lot of controversy. Manhattan shouldn't have gotten in the field. Didn't have enough quality wins. We play Oklahoma on a Thursday. If you do brackets, if you do NCAA brackets, and you want to pick an upset, pick an early in the day Thursday game, because the favored team, sometimes they come out and they sleepwalk, whereas the underdog is pumped and ready to go. We were pumped and ready. We beat the daylights out of Oklahoma. In the second half, we were up 15, and they had dominated what was then the Big 12. It was the Big 8. They dominated the Big 8 that year, and now it's the Big 12. But we kicked the daylights out of them, and Bob Frederick is sitting courtside at the game in Memphis. And I was cool and calm and collected. I go down to shake Kelvin's hands, you know, good game. And Bob was sitting about where Bernie was sitting. And he looked at me, I made eye contact with him because he was a chair of the committee. He took a lot of heat for us getting in. And I winked at him as if to say, you knew what you were doing. And I went into the press conference and they had those NCAA logos there. It's a great thrill for a young coach. I was like 34 years old. And, you know, they asked me, well, first question, coach, were you surprised? And I said, looks like the basketball committee knew what they were doing. Okay, because that was a big deal. So I go to St. John's. And I wanted to just tell that story because I wanted to honor Bob, because Bob meant so much to this university. I go to St. John's. I take over a bad team, okay, what had been a great program. And my first year, my very first meeting, I got one of my players bringing a bag of Wendy's into my first team meeting, okay? Think about that. He was going to eat lunch in my meeting. This is why they were losing. Okay, because they had no respect. So I said, no, we're not eating lunch in my meeting. You guys all come back tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. and we'll start again. And that first year, we made some progress. The second year, my second year, now it's 5 years that we haven't been to the tournament. I also had a freshman on that team by the name of Ron Artest, now known as Meta World Peace, okay? He was crazy, but people always say, how did you coach Ron Artest? And I said, I was crazier than him. Because when I would see the temper start to boil, I would just, like, it was an act, lose my mind and go nuts and throw him out of practice. Okay, but anyways, Ron's first year. We have a team meeting. Every coach in the country has a team meeting the day before classes start. Okay, football, you guys can't do that because you got to come back a month before. But in basketball, if school starts on August 28th, we have the meeting Sunday night, the 27th. And I have a big meeting, hour and a half, lay it all out. Okay? Begin with the end in mind. That's going to be the moral of the story. So I hand out these T-shirts. Remember, it's year two. We haven't been to the tournament in a while. Nobody in my program has ever been to the NCAA tournament. They can't even imagine it. They can't even imagine what it's like. I hand out these T-shirts, Club 186. And they're all looking at me. It says St. John's on the front, Club 186 on the back. They're looking at me like, what's this T-shirt about? I said, hey, guys, we're 186 days away from Selection Sunday. And none of you guys have ever been in the NCAA tournament. Let me tell you about it, because I've been there, whatever it was back then, 5 or 6 or 7 times. I said, first of all, it's the greatest feeling in the world when your name's going to pop up on that screen. It's going to say St. John's versus Purdue at the United Center in Chicago. Okay, I said, that's the first thing that's going to happen. Now, this is in our team meeting. I said, secondly, we're going to be celebrating that night. We're going to have a big hall, kind of like over at the where they have the rules, that cafeteria there. I'm going to put TVs in there, bring our fans. We're going to have a big selection Sunday party. What do you want, guys? Who wants chicken wings? Guys raise. I want chicken wings, coach. How about potato skins? We're going to have potato skins, you know? How about spinach dip? Yeah, coach, spinach dip too. Okay. I want you to think about this because this is what's going to happen that Sunday night. Then we're going to practice for 2 days. All the New York media is going to be coming in because you're going to have made a little bit of history here as being a St. John's team to get them back to the tournament. Then we're flying to Chicago on Tuesday on a charter. We're going to land at O'Hare. We're going to go to the hotel. They're going to have St. John's signs there at the Marriott downtown, whatever. And then we're going to go over to the United Center later that day, and we're going to practice. And they have open practice. Who's been to the NCAA tournament where they have the open practices, right? You go see the Jayhawks. Well, I told these guys, UCLA is going to practice before us. And then when they're coming off the court, we get our hour on the court. Every team gets an hour at the United Center where the Michael Jordan statue is. So I got these guys thinking about it, okay? And I said, it's going to be an unbelievable feeling. Bill Raftery and Grant Hill are going to come over and be interviewing you at the practice, and it's going to be, UCLA is going to come off. You're going to be dapping guys that you played AAU against. Hey, what's up, man? Yeah, good luck to you, you know. And then as you get done practicing, here comes Villanova. And I'm creating this picture on the day before classes started in August. And so now we get done with the meeting, and throughout the year, it wasn't no longer 186 days. Now it was 150. It was 98. And now we're playing well. And there would be days I'd come out to practice in January when it's 11 degrees out, and the guys, some guy had three classes and two exams, and another guy was up all night with a project, and I'd come out on the court, and I could tell it was those, one of those days where, you know, guys don't really want to be at practice, that's human nature, and I'd just come out and I'd go, oh yeah, 56 days, I smell the chicken wings, and they would laugh, because we were talking about the finish line. And we got to the point by the end of the year, 24 days, 21 days, 20 days, we knew we were going to the tournament. Okay, and we did. We wound up losing in the final game of the regular season to Connecticut for the Big East title. After the year before, we were like 5-13. But the whole point was we began with the end in mind. Okay, and When we got selected that night, we had that party. We had the chicken wings. We had the potato skins. I wanted them to know what the feeling was like before we started. So the point is this. As you start to think about your career, you must begin with the end in mind. Okay? And for many of you out there, you're not sure yet what you want to do. But you have to have that feeling. Okay, you cannot start out on your life's journey without knowing where the finish line is. I know we got some athletes in here. We got football guys here trying to turn their program around. Everybody wants to see it on campus. Same thing. Got to change the culture. You got to do something different that hasn't been done in a while. That's kind of fun. It's fun to take on that challenge. Okay, begin with the end in mind. Second thing. You gotta set a high standard for yourself. I got my notes on here, so let me just go back to this, and because I don't want to forget anything. Set a high standard. I think I was lucky when I left coaching. I was like the 34th winningest coach in the country at the time. I had some really good teams. And I left coaching to go to broadcasting. Part of it, I was coaching at the University of New Mexico after I left St. John's. I tell everybody I retired because of illness. They got sick of me out there. Okay? It means I resigned. That's how I started my TV career. But when I was coaching, I was fortunate. I coached against Jim Boeheim and Jim Calhoun and you know, a lot of the great coaches you see on TV now, Tom Izzo, people that are friends of mine. We beat Arizona 1 year when I was at New Mexico. They had a 60-game home winning streak. We beat Connecticut 1 year. when they had a 60-game home winning streak. None of those are all highlights to some people. To me, the best moment of my coaching career, I'm coaching at Manhattan College. We practiced as hard as any team in the country. We really did. We believe that. And I had a team that at this point, this was a team that beat Oklahoma. We were 19-3, and it was mid-February. And I wanted to give them a day off, but I didn't want them to know that I was satisfied. Coaches play mind games all the time, okay? They do. So I wanted to, we didn't have a game until Saturday, and it was a Wednesday practice. I wanted them to rest because you get to this time of year right now in college basketball, guys are tired of practicing. Ladies, if any women basketball players in here, you're tired of it because you've been doing this since August. So I said to my coaching staff, we're going to give the guys a day off. And he said, and the guy said, what do you mean? I said, I'm going to make something up in the first 5 minutes of practice, act like I'm mad, and kick them out. We're going to have a day off. They're just not going to know it. Okay, because we're rolling. We're 19-3. We're kicking ass. So sure enough, 5 minutes in, and we practiced our butts off. I'm telling you, we had high school coaches from all over New York and New Jersey come just to, and they used to say to me after practice, how do you get these guys to play so hard? You know, and part of it was in their DNA because of the guys we tried to recruit, and part of it is you can foster toughness. You can foster toughness. And I'm not talking about physical toughness all the time of getting, you know, beating people up. I'm talking about toughness, period. Mental toughness, physical toughness. A lot of you probably have had summer jobs where it wasn't fun work, okay? But it was good money and it paid the bills, okay? So you can foster toughness by the way a coach can set up practice. So this one day, I'm going to throw him out to give him the day off. And 5 minutes in, one of my players throws a ball away, throws it over a guy's head, and I go ballistic. I mean, it's a great acting job. You guys think, and I'm not going to use the words I've used in here out of respect to all of you, but you guys think you're better than you are. You're 19-3. You think it doesn't stink. You guys get the hell out of here. I'll see you tomorrow. So everybody's stunned. And I go up to my office, and my assistant coaches come up to the office. And they go, Coach, that was a great job, man. You really had us going there. And 5 minutes later, one of my managers comes in and says, Coach, they're practicing. I said, what do you mean they're practicing? They said, no, they're practicing. They took the practice plan, and they're still practicing. They're coaching themselves. And my assistant coaches said, should we go down there? And I said, no, it's not our team anymore. It's their team. They had so much pride in the way we practiced every day, they thought they were letting me down. They thought they were letting me down. And that was better than any win I've ever had in my life because I had trained this group of 14 guys that in order to be good or be great, that we had to set a high standard every single day. And it got to the point where they took, you've heard this term in maybe some of your classes, take ownership, right? Great teams take ownership, okay? Great teams have ownership in the locker room. I could have left my teams for 3 or 4 days and let the captains coach the team, and there would have been no slippage. You gotta have a high standard. Whatever you do with your career, okay, you must create a high standard. You want people pushing you, whether it's your professors, whether it's your coaches, whether it's your boss at work, you want people bringing out the best in you. Now, I sent Jordan a few. I don't know if any of you read those articles. I don't care, okay? But I'm just telling you right now as a piece of advice. Angela Duckworth, she's a professor at Penn. And I sent those articles, and she's gotten very close to a number of coaches and sports teams, Pete Carroll in particular. And if you didn't read those articles, I'll just tell you what grit is, okay? Grit is passion plus perseverance for long-term goals, okay? Grit equals passion plus perseverance for long-term goals. She wrote a book that is a bestseller right now. It's mostly an easy read, okay? He's got a great chapter on there on the culture of the Seattle Seahawks. She's a woman who did studies on why some inner city kids who aren't as intelligent as other inner city kids end up doing better in school. She did a study on why some West Point U.S. Military Academy cadets, would you agree that in order to get into West Point, you got to be very bright, right? You got to have a lot of talent in terms of brain talent. Would we agree with that? Why do some West Point cadets, 30% of them drop out, and why do 70% stay? It's not intelligence, because they're all intelligent. You can't get into an academy unless you're very, very bright. And her determination was, and the reason I'm bringing this up to you is, as I've been in this sports business my whole life, I don't care how much talent you have, okay? To me, the secret sauce to success is grit. Do you have the passion for what you're doing? I don't know how you could be out on a football field and get your head beat in every day if you didn't have that passion for playing the game. It makes no sense. It's a stupid sport in some ways, even though we all love it. We all love watching college and pro football. To see those guys, and I know we've got a few guys in the room that are just hitting each other every day, you better have passion for that sport and the perseverance to stick with it. I think of Tom Brady, okay? Did you ever see that thing on ESPN, that 30 for 30, where there were six quarterbacks taken before, I think it was six, maybe there were more, taken before Tom Brady in the draft that he came out? And they showed Tom Brady running the 40. Did anybody remember ever seeing Tom Brady run a 40? That was not graceful, okay? Now, he's maybe the best quarterback, maybe. Got to make the argument now he's the best quarterback to ever play the game of football based on what he's accomplished, okay? And when you read about Tom Brady, I love reading about Brady and Belichick. When I think about Tom Brady, I don't think about his talent. I think about his grit. This guy has the passion and the perseverance, and this guy wants to play till he's 45 years old. I don't know much about Bill Gates. I don't know much about Steve Jobs. Some of these business guys that have revolutionized our world. I can only imagine that these guys have grit. Okay, to me, I promise you, either read that book or read those articles, because we probably have some very intelligent people in this room, but it's been my experience over the course of my life and career in sports that having that type of mental toughness, call it whatever you want, grit, is way more important to someone being successful than having talent. If you have talent plus grit, now you have somebody who's really elite. Kobe Bryant comes to mind. Can't say that he wasn't a very talented basketball player, but I read everything I could about what made Kobe great. Guy gets up at 3 a.m., calls his trainer, meet me at the gym. It's almost a sickness to some people, that passion. Okay? And I really encourage you, do not work for a living. Okay? Getting a job stinks. Find something you truly love that you can get paid to do and have that grit, that long-term perseverance that you'll stay with it. If you want to stay in sports, you're going to work for very little money initially. Okay? I've got a son that's a grad assistant coach at Indiana University. He's working literally 18 hours a day right now. If you follow college basketball, yes, this team that beat Kansas, first game of the year, right? Then they lost a couple key guys. Now they're struggling. They're not going to be in the tournament, okay? He's in a great spot. Even though the coach may leave, may get fired, I don't know, may leave on his own, my son's in a great spot because He's putting in 18-hour days. He's probably making $800 a month, basically paying his room and board, okay? But he's in a great spot because he's learning how to be a college basketball coach. And he's putting in that time and that effort. And if he doesn't want to do it, he texted me like 2 months ago and he said, I'd rather be working at a 7-Eleven store. That's what he texted me one night. And I texted him back. This is what you wanted to do. So now everything's good. Even though they're still struggling a little bit, everything's good because what I told him was, this is coaching. This is what coaching is. You know, you're gonna lose and you're gonna win. It's gonna suck. But if this is what you wanna do, this is how you have to pay the price. Okay, so that's my two cents for you. Grit, passion, plus perseverance for long-term goals. I don't care if you go to law school, you go to med school, you open up your own business. You ask anybody who's an entrepreneur who's had businesses open and then close, and it's taken 3 or 4 failures before they hit it. Restaurant business, it's all about grit. If you have talent to go with it, consider yourself lucky. I was an average student, 3-0. I don't want you to think I was, you know, I had a 3-0 in Brooklyn College. Majored in American history. Got a degree that, other than the fact that I like history, did nothing for me except I knew I wanted to be a coach. Okay, last thing, and then I want to open it up because I don't want to bore you. So we talked about begin with the end in mind, okay? Set a high standard for yourself. Grit. Last thing is leave a legacy, okay? A lot of people in this room, if they can, still pay back the people that have helped them along the way. Parents, relatives, older siblings, coaches, teachers. Always try to pay back as much as you can right now at your age, okay? Thank people for what they've done for you so far. A lot of people, you're at the University of Kansas, your students here. I know we have some athletes in the room as well who should feel very fortunate that they're able to compete intercollegiately at the college level at a great place like this. Just about everybody in here should be thankful for what they're doing right now. And I think if you take inventory of your life so far, there's probably people that have come into your life, again, relatives, friends, coaches, teachers, that you should be thinking about thanking them every chance you get. That's paying back, okay? Paying them back. And even paying them back with a thank you. Even going back to your high school, going to your math teacher who you couldn't stand at the time and just thanking them. You know what, the stuff I took a math class at KU, can't believe how ahead of the game I was because how tough you are on me. Coaching the same way, parents. I mean, anybody who's never been upset with a mom and dad who's put a foot up their ass, I feel bad for you if you haven't had that happen, okay? Payback, because there's gonna come a point in your life where you're not gonna be able to pay back. They're gonna pass away, some may even already have, okay? But as you get older, the people who have helped you in your life, they're not gonna be around to pay them back and thank them. And that's when you learn, and you can learn it right now in college, pay forward. Pay it forward, you've heard that expression. It might be something as simple as going back to your high school where you played high school basketball and talking to the young ladies that are there and say, hey, don't pass up on this opportunity to play for Coach. Listen to what Coach Jones is saying. She really helped me. Now that I'm in college, she was a big influence on me. It could be paying forward in a million different ways. Getting involved in Special Olympics on campus, getting involved with all the different things on campus that where you're, you know, community service. Some of you are gonna get to a point in your careers where you're gonna pay forward even more than you could ever have imagined. Somebody in here might be the general manager of the Kansas City Royals 25 years from now, and they're gonna remember what they learned at the KU sports management program. You know, I'm gonna hire 3 KU kids every year because of what that program meant to me. And there's a million ways. I can give you a million ways of how you're gonna be able to pay it forward, okay? But paying back and pay it forward means you're leaving a legacy. Okay? Somebody came before you. Someone's coming after you here. Okay? And for those of you who are on the teams here, you're going to be a senior when someone's a freshman. Got some freshmen in the room, right? Hopefully there's some guys in the football program now that are paying forward to you guys. Whether they are or not, you can do the same to the next group that comes up, okay? I've been blessed. I've had the greatest life. By the way, I've been fired twice from coaching jobs, okay? I left behind a team at St. John's in 1998 and the reason I was fired, I don't say this very often because it's not a big deal. I was a coach at St. John's with two little boys, and I got offered the Arizona State job for twice the money. Would have set up my family for life, and actually St. John's set up my family for life. I'll tell you that about that in a second. The athletic director at Arizona State is now the athletic director at Duke University, Kevin White. Before that, he was the AD at Notre Dame. So this guy's big time. He's been the AD at arguably the greatest football program in the history of college football, arguably. I coach at Ohio State, so I can't really say that. But this guy's a big-time guy. And at that time, he was the AD at Arizona State. And Dick Vitale and all these friends of mine were telling me, take the job. I interviewed. I had a really good team coming back at St. John's. I turned the job down at Arizona State. It would have doubled my salary. About 4 weeks later, the president of St. John's, it's a Catholic school, Catholic priest. By the way, the longer you work at a Catholic school, the less likely you are to believe in God. No, I didn't say that. I'm just joking. But this guy fired me because he thought I was disloyal. I was one of the hot young coaches in the country. Seriously, I was. I turned around Manhattan. We were turning around St. John's. The next year, they hired the guy they replaced me with went to the Elite Eight, came within 3 points of the Final Four with my team, and St. John's has never recovered. Coach Roberts was the only guy, Norm Roberts on Bill's staff, he's the only guy that coached at St. John's that I rooted for after I left, okay? But I got hit over the head with a 2x4, okay, when I was on top of the world. I mean, I was winning. I was a damn good coach. I still am, except I decided to make a lifestyle change because I wanted to watch my kids grow up. That's why tonight's going to be really fun. Who's going to the game tonight? You're going to see something really special tonight. Just trust me when I tell you, it's not going to be a typical senior night, okay? That's my little tease, okay? But when I got fired, really for no reason, I had to pick myself up. You talk about grit, passion, and perseverance. I was out of coaching a year. Then I went to New Mexico for 3 years. And then I got a chance to go to ESPN where I've had an unbelievable time. I'm undefeated. I get to talk basketball. My friends are coaching. I get to hang out with great kids, great student athletes, coaching friends of mine. And my wife says they don't pay me to work. They pay me to travel. I have to get up 5 o'clock in the morning in Portland, Oregon, and make it to Morgantown by that night, change planes in Chicago. It's not a big deal because I don't have a job, okay? So begin with the end in mind, set a high standard, understand what grit is all about, and leave a legacy. Pay forward and pay back and pay forward. Questions?
Let's do it.
All right, let's do it. Whatever you want, career, want advice? Who's going to win the title? You want me to fill out your bracket for you?
Being from New York and then now covering the Big 12 extensively, what would you say is similar and different between the coaches?
Well, I've been a basketball fan my whole life, okay? And when I was a kid, and we didn't have it. See, you guys don't realize this. I know I'm really sounding my age now, but we didn't have ESPN when I was a kid, so we got like, if there were 5 college games on a weekend, that was a lot, okay? And now there's 500 games on. I always loved watching games from places like Allen Fieldhouse, these big on-campus state university arenas with the whole state is cheering for the team. You know, that was always big to me. I loved watching Ohio State football when I was a kid. Ohio State, Michigan was one of those games on TV. Notre Dame, big stadium. So what I love about, now I live in Dallas now, and I was once offered the University of Tulsa job, when Tubby Smith left, because my Manhattan team was really good, I turned it down because I wanted to stay in New York. But to get to your question, they hired another guy who did a good job, and he left. He went to Florida State. And then Tulsa hired this young up-and-coming guy from Oral Roberts by the name of Bill Self. Okay, Bill Self coached at Tulsa. But the East Coast primarily is pro sports, kind of like Southern California. Like even when UCLA, this is rare that UCLA is really good and they're selling out Pauly. They're selling it out because Alonzo Ball is like an unbelievable player. He's like Magic Johnson. But even UCLA doesn't sell out normally. Same thing on the East Coast. So what I love about this part of the country, I make my home in Dallas now, last 14 years, is I just like college atmospheres. And there's no better college atmosphere in basketball in the country, Duke, I don't care, Carolina, Indiana, than this place. There's no place like Allen Fieldhouse in the country. If you are a student that goes to every game, consider yourself lucky, because it is not this way in every place. And that's why I like Hilton, by the way. For those of you who think I cheer for Iowa State over KU, no. I like the underdog. I like when Iowa State plays KU toe-to-toe and it goes to the wire, because I think it's good for the league and it's good for college basketball. And I don't root for the other team, okay? I'm kidding. I am kidding. Yes?
What's the most exciting game you ever commentated?
Good question. Most exciting game I've ever commentated. There's been a lot. There was a kid at Texas by the name of Kevin Durant when he was a freshman, and we did a double overtime game between Texas A&M, when they were in the Big 12. AC Law was their great player, he was an NBA player. Kevin Durant was unbelievable in college, and that was probably the most exciting game. By the way, probably one of the greatest performances ever in this building was Kevin Durant's first half in here when he had 27, and I think he got hurt in the second half, tweaked an ankle. Probably, I wasn't here. I was in Manhattan that day. I was doing a game at K-State, but I remember watching it on TV. 27 in the first half against a really good KU team in Allen Fieldhouse. So I get to do a lot of them. I like overtime games. I like places where the crowd is jacked. And that, hate to say it, that Iowa State game a couple weeks ago was really exciting just because of the streak. Yes, I'm going to call on you because – it's a good question. The way I try to do my job, not everybody knows as much basketball as I do. So I try to talk to the viewer so that even if you're a casual fan, you understand what I'm talking about. So what I try to do for every broadcast is I want to tell you something about Frank Mason that you might not have ever heard before. Okay? Anybody know Frank went to a military prep school in Virginia? Some of you do, some of you don't. Okay? Frank wasn't a great student in high school, he'll tell you that. And the military prep school where he had to get up at 6:30 every morning kind of woke him up a little bit. So when I do a game, I try to tell people something about the players, coaches, teams that's a little different and unique that they haven't heard, even though I've done like 10 KU games this year. But I also have to explain the game on TV so that every fan understands and not just those that love the game. You know, they have a lot of knowledge about the game. So my mother in Brooklyn, she doesn't know the difference between a pumpkin and a basketball. She doesn't. So every now and then I'll say, she'll say to me after she watches, I like the way you explained, the 3-second rule or whatever. So I try to keep it simple because here's what happens. Anybody here want to coach? Got some people want to coach? Sometimes your best players are your slowest learners. Okay? Sometimes your best players don't pick up things as quickly as some of the other guys. And you have to coach them so that they understand. Because if they don't understand, your team's screwed. Because they're your best player. Same thing with broadcasting. I try to explain the game so that anybody who's listening can say, I never knew that before. It's the first time I've ever heard anybody say that. Anybody ever hear me say one dribble per second? Okay. If you get the ball out of bounds, like at the other end line, you can get from one end of the court to the other in 4 seconds. Most guards, college guards, okay? And I used to teach that to my players when I was coaching. So if there was a last second play and it's tied at 70, we had no more timeouts left, and one of my guys got a rebound and they looked up at the clock and it was 5 seconds, they knew they had five dribbles. They knew they could go coast to coast in five dribbles because we practiced it. We didn't have to look at the clock. And we didn't need to worry about timeouts or not. Little things like that. People go, oh, yeah, wow, one dribble per second. That's pretty cool. Never heard that before. Because I didn't want the guy getting the ball with 4 seconds, taking one dribble from three-quarter court and throwing it up from three-quarter court when it's 3-2-1 when they had three more dribbles to get up the court. That makes sense? That's not real complicated. That's how I try to explain the game to viewers. Yes? Well, Villanova is probably a small school, but a great team. They're small. They're not a state school. But the beauty of college basketball, as opposed to football, is you only need five really good players. All right? In football, obviously, you needed 30, 40, whatever, more the better. Great thing about the NCAA tournament is some school that you've never heard of, like who was it last year? Middle Tennessee State knocked off who? Who remembers? Michigan State. Okay? 2 seed versus a 15 seed. Beauty of the tournament. Okay, so yes, I do like that. I like underdogs too, because I was an underdog. Okay, in the back, redhead. My feeling is that if you're good enough to leave high school and go to the NBA and you want to do it, you should be able to do it. It's a free country. Golfers, tennis players, you know, you want to quit school and go start a startup computer software company. You can do that right out of high school if you're capable of it. Problem is, 98% of those kids are not going to be Kobe, KG, or whoever else has come out. My personal opinion is if you go to college, you should be made to stay two instead of one. I wish it was a two and done, but that's not an NCAA rule. I don't know if you know this. That's an NBA rule. That's part of the NBA's collective bargaining agreement. So right now the rule is one and done. How many, let me ask you this. How many rookies are averaging double figures in the NBA this year? Who? Well, Joel is, but he's hurt right now. Okay. Joel and Dario are two guys that weren't even in last year's draft class, but they are rookies. Of the guys that were drafted last year, the last I checked, Buddy was averaging 8.5. I could be wrong. Okay. All right. So I don't think there's a – so here's my point. What you watch tonight when you go to the game, okay, that's what I call the equivalent of double-A baseball. That's not even triple-A. NBA is major leagues. Triple-A is those leagues in Europe where those guys are men, like Porzingis coming over when he was 20 years old a couple of years ago. College basketball is double-A baseball. Not to say that whoever, Frank Mason, Josh Jackson, you know, we know they're going to – play in the NBA. I think Frank's going to play in the NBA. I think he's going to make a team. But what they're doing right now, this is double A. It's so hard to make the jump from Division I. I don't care if you play at Duke or Carolina or Kansas to the NBA because those guys are grown men, which is proven every year in the NBA draft because very few guys have an impact. And this year, no double figure scorers.
Do you think Northwestern's going to finally make it?
It's going to be close. They've lost like 7 out of 9, 8 out of 10. It's going to be tight. They got two more games. They're two tough games, Purdue and Michigan.
Who's the first person taken in the NBA draft?
It should be Markelle Fultz or Lonzo Ball. And I'm telling you, I love them both, and I can't decide yet as a fan. Yes, ma'am. It's a great question. How did I get into broadcasting is the question, without any journalism background. I grew up with a gift of gab. Okay, I was not real smart, average student, maybe a little better than average. I love the game. I love to talk. So when my coaching career was kind of winding down, and I left when I was 43, and I've had about 15 chances to go back to coaching. I'm done. But when I was young, like younger, 15 years ago, even though I got to ESPN, I always had coaching opportunities. ESPN hired me on a whim, gave me a chance. I love talking the game. I love explaining the game. I have a passion for the game. It's worked out great. I wasn't a big name back then. I mean, I was a coach. People knew my name, but I was more of a long name than a big name. I got a chance to coach at ESPN, to work at ESPN. And because I love the game, love to talk the game, it's worked out well. And I'm prepared. Yes. Well, it was partly made for me at New Mexico. I had three teams that went to the NIT out there, and I had two more years of my contract. And New Mexico is a very tough place to coach. It has the same pressure of KU without the resources. They think that the Lobos should be in the Final Four, and it's a very hard place to coach. When I had a chance to go to ESPN, I thought I would take some time off, go back to coaching, watch my kids grow up for a couple years. And it turned out that the lifestyle fit me better than coaching, and I stayed with it. One of the things I subscribe to is don't mess with happy. Okay, too many people chase things that they think are going to make them happy when they got happy right in front of them. How many more we got?
Three more, man.
Three more. Let's go right here.
Have you ever worked alongside Bill Walton? And
if so, how'd that go? After Saturday, KU fans are ecstatic that I'm back. You know, he's a very passionate guy. He's unique. For those of you who don't know, if he didn't get hurt, Bill Walton was one of the greatest players to ever play the game. I'm talking about in there with Kareem and Wilt. I mean, Bill Walton is one, because he was healthy in college, is arguably one of the three greatest college players in history, in my opinion. Kareem, Wilt, maybe Bill Russell, Bill Walton. Forget Bird, Oscar, whoever, Michael Jordan. So Bill Walton, great player, a lot of injuries, free thinker, a lot of dead brain cells. We know why, okay? But he's passionate about what he does. And even though he's a different style than me, he prepares. I was in Maui with him last year. We did different sets of games. When KU was in Maui, I did the KU games at night, and he did the afternoon games. He's unique. I can only listen to him for a little bit at a time, but he is passionate. Green.
I
love basketball. You know, I'm like the international guru only because nobody at ESPN wanted to be. And I had a lot of players play overseas. And they gave me the job as international draft expert. At the very same time, 13 years ago, ESPN said, "Would you like to be our international expert on the draft?" One of my former players, who's an NBA personnel guy, was the guy responsible for running a great camp in Italy with all the best international guys. So I actually coached at the camp. And in coaching at the camp and bridging it with the ESPN role on draft night, I fell in love with international hoops. I worked for NBC this summer. I did the Olympics. And the reason I love international basketball is because I love basketball. It's just another part of basketball. Two more. Let me get somebody else, if you don't mind. In the back.
What's the best runner or test story?
Okay, so I told you that I would see him. Do you have friends that you can tell before they lose their temper? They're about to lose it? You have people that you can tell it's... Okay, well, that's how Ron Artest was. So I was very tough on him at practice. Now, I'm 5'7", like whatever, 175. And Ron is probably still 6'7", 260, okay? One of the greatest athletes I've ever been around. So he could obviously squash me. But he respected authority. He was a very bright student in high school, and he respected authority. And a lot of people with guys like him who are intimidating physical presences, they kind of let him slide. And when Ron would do something wrong in practice, I would jump in his ass. And he kind of liked it. Okay, because he wanted to be coached. He wanted to be coached. So I would, on occasion, throw him out of practice. And I would say, you know, get the hell out of here. You know, get to the locker room, you sorry, whatever. I mean, you can only imagine. I mean, that's G. Okay, I'm talking about big time X-rated. So, but when you threw Ron out of practice, you know, most guys, you throw him out of practice. Hey, get out of practice. Go to the locker room. Get out of here. They go to the locker room, they put a towel over their head. Assistant coach comes in. Okay, you sorry? You ready to come back? Okay. When you threw Ron out of practice, you had to send two assistant coaches into the locker room right after him. Because if there was a TV on the, mounted to the wall, if there was anything that could be ripped off a wall, Ron would do it. So you'd throw him out, but you had to go back and chase him in there with two assistants. But we have a great relationship now because I challenged him. And guess what he wants to do? He wants to coach. Okay, he's on that Laker bench. He's a mentor to young guys. And he was never crazy off the court. Okay, the big fight at the Palace, Malice at the Palace, a lot of you were really young back then. That was competitive genes. Off the court, you guys don't know this, NBA Citizen of the Year about 6-7 years ago for work he did in Africa with malaria and AIDS. Great human being off the court. Crazy on the court. Calmed down since, but I love coaching him. Well, you'll find out in your life that it's a lot easier to slow somebody down than to check their pulse rate. All right, last one. I know you got to go to class. Yes, New York Mets. I'm a Mets fan. I have no idea. I honestly, do not even look at my bracket. Because it blows up like within the first morning, right? The first afternoon. There's a lot of good teams. Here's what I worry about with KU. KU's as good as anybody. KU's got the whole thing. Depth, an injury, an ankle sprain, foul trouble. And it was one other. Inside, as good as Landon Lucas has played this year, he's been unbelievable. Because he has to stay out of foul trouble, Yante Mayton from Georgia had 30. Brodziansky from TCU had 28. This kid Allen has averaged 21-15 from Texas in the two meetings. So a team like North Carolina would scare me because of their inside size. But KU's got as good a chance as any to win. If they win the Big 12 tournament and they win the opening two rounds of the NCAA tournament, they have a chance to play 8 games at the Sprint Center this year, okay? Because they played in the CBE and they were allowed one other game, they played Davidson. Hey, really enjoyed it. Just remember those things I mentioned to you. Grit, hey, last thing, grit. Passion plus perseverance. Read up on her. That's what life's all about. If you got toughness, grit, passion, perseverance, you'll be successful. Thank you.